You also see, everybody, that we have an illustrious panel here of digital champions who Terry is going to introduce you to in more detail shortly. But the first of those champions who represents higher education is Dr. Ian McLaren. Ian has been a member of the National Forum Board from the very start, when we established the board in 2013. But more importantly than that, in his own quiet, very humble way, and he doesn't like to draw too much attention to himself, he has been an extraordinary leader of the transformation agenda. His articulation and collaboration with very many institutions right across the sector of the digital skills framework that you now see as the All Aboard framework has been such an important ingredient. It might look like a relatively simple set of skills, but the idea that we now have a framework, the map that David talked about that young people don't have, I like to believe that the national, that the All Aboard framework provides a really important part of that map in terms of skills development and in terms of the journey towards competence and imagination and creativity. Ian has been a huge leader in the teaching and learning enhancement agenda. He's been a very effective and hardworking board member of the National Forum, and I think it's always incredibly interesting to listen to him. He's going to talk today about the origins of the All Aboard framework, which I think is, as I said, is such an important part of the work that we're all doing and the future that we're all embracing. Ian, you're very welcome. The podium's yours.
Thanks very much. I'll try my best to live up to some of that. So I'm just going to talk briefly about the idea that led to All Aboard and about some of the main features of the All Aboard project as it started, when it was restricted initially, as you can see, to focusing on the issues of higher education, what the challenges are in higher education in dealing with the digital world that we've heard so eloquently about by David. So I'm not going to go into a lot of detail, I just want to focus on three main features of that project. The first one is coming to terms with mapping out in a kind of general sense where we were as a sector in terms of the digital technologies, both in terms of how students use the technologies and how staff use the technologies. And one of the early parts of the project was focusing on perhaps developing a new national digital skills framework that we could use to go forward. So, in a sense, we're talking about the classic problem that we often hear about, that students need high levels of skill and confidence for employment, that academic staff need skills to be able to provide up-to-date learning experiences, and also that support staff need skills to develop their specialist expertise, and that's something that we didn't often hear about in the past, but we were very, very conscious of in the All Aboard project, that there's a huge number of people in all sorts of roles working in education at all levels whose role is actually crucial for successful education, but they're often not necessarily bundled into these kind of summary talks when you talk about students and academic staff. There's a whole lot of other people as well. So, if you've got an issue like this, as many countries have, of course, digital skills gap, then the typical solution would be for a project team like ourselves to perhaps sit down and draft a formal competency framework document, come up with a set of policies and standards and take it through various committees and so forth. Now, the thing is, when we started on the project and we thought about this challenge, to be honest, our response to this kind of typical approach that you would find in academia was probably because, you know, when you look at the literature, we found 60 pre-existing digital skills or digital literacies frameworks. Huge numbers of documents, lots of work, it's good work, it's good solid work. But somehow, the gap between books on the shelves and the lived reality in the classroom or in the other parts of the institution, the gap was just so wide. So what we wanted to try and see, and we didn't know whether we would succeed or not, but what we wanted to try and see was if we could try something a little bit different, perhaps a bit more imaginative. We gathered people together, we had workshops, there were
active workshops and sessions, and we tried to get people's opinions and perspectives from all across the sector and beyond. And of course, we paid great detailed attention to those 60 pre-existing frameworks. We incorporated the literature and so forth. But we wanted people to feel part of something. That's really the ethos of All Aboard. So we got people to give us their ideas, and we jotted them all down, the sorts of things that should maybe be considered in a digital skills framework. And of course, there's lots of different ideas all over the place, lots of different things. But we wanted to try and see if we could make sense of these ideas, if we could perhaps structure them into some sort of arrangement. And perhaps there was a way in which we could help people make sense of this really complex digital landscape that we're all living, working, and studying in. And that's when the idea of coming up with some sort of visual representation came to us. And we thought about different ways of doing it. But one of our colleagues on the team, Blonath Micheal, she actually came up with this particular suggestion, which we then adopted, which was that we could see ways of navigating complicated landscapes by using maps, and why not use an actual map? So that's really the origin of the metro map metaphor that we adopted in the project. But what we were really surprised by, pleasantly surprised, was by how many people really felt they could relate to that simple infographic. Now, that infographic has been used in many other contexts before, but it did seem to strike a chord with so many of the people that we were trying to reach, and many other people as well. And the whole notion, I guess you can extend the metaphor as far as you want, the whole notion of going on a journey, of exploring a new city, of, you know, crossing lines. Everything doesn't have to be in the one kind of package. So that notion really, as I say, is what lies behind the All Aboard metro map metaphor. Now, if you still like your traditional frameworks, we also have documents that summarize that for people who like that. And we've also got a nice, clear structure to the actual metro. But I think the thing is, what we really learned, and this to some extent echoes what David was saying, that there's a tremendous power in the visual. And it's been fantastic to see how many people really, as I say, took to this notion. So that was the first thing that we did, was try and make sense. And we also wanted to try and make things, we hoped, a bit more fun and creative and participatory. So the second thing that I'm going to mention here is we also believed that we should be providing open access materials to anyone. And we shouldn't necessarily structure training programs or workshops just for specific groups of people, just tied to their specific job role or whatever it was. We wanted to make things open in the hope that that would also encourage other people to contribute. I'd like nothing better than for somebody to say to me, oh, I could do much better than that. That's great. So please do it. So we wanted to create a framework where people felt they could contribute. So we embraced the whole idea of openness. And we also embrace the idea of digital badges. Now, digital badges, many people are familiar with them. Some people don't like them because they don't like the concept of a badge, which I'll explain in a few minutes. It sounds a bit trite and a bit childish. For those people, we talk about micro-credentials, and that seems to keep them calm for a little while. But what we found out is that the best way to convert people to the idea of awarding digital badges is to give them one. And then they ask, when can they get the next one? You won't believe how many professors hold a whole string of digital badges now, who would never have gone near the concept if we'd just described it to them. But we have to make sense of our metro. So so what we've done is, in each of the little stations, each station on the map is a topic, a subject or a concept that's really important, that our broader community felt was important enough for us to put it into the map. So in each station, what we've done is we've begun to create digital, online, interactive lessons and study materials. Very, very simple style, hopefully reasonably open and accessible in terms of the language and the structure that's used. so people can pop in to one of these stations and simply work their way through the little online lesson. And if they complete the various tasks that are there, they're automatically awarded a digital badge. So it's a very straightforward thing. It's not about embedding courses of so many ECTS into the program and, you know, really kind of get a complex monolithic kind of certificates and structures like that. It's something that people can dip into and just do if they feel, actually, I'd like to learn a little bit more about that. Here's a source for them to get that information, and also to get some recognition for the achievement they've demonstrated, and that's the role of the badge. The digital badge is a mark of achievement or the attainment of a skill. We've also realized that it's possible, if you look at the Metro map and you have all these lessons and resources, because there's lots of other materials as well. There's, for example, tools to help people run local workshops on the topic. That you could take the map and you could actually construct your own journey around that city, going, crossing from metro line to metro line, visiting different stations. And in a sense, if you collect some of those little journeys together, you're effectively building a curriculum. So we've extended our little metaphor into that domain as well by creating what we call travel cards. And here's an example of one of them, the Student Zone 1 travel card. And what that is it specifies 6 stations that you might like to visit and you might like to do the lessons on and work through them. And if you do those 6 particular lessons that we've just picked for that example, you will be awarded a badge higher up the hierarchy, which is the travel card. And we're doing that for all sorts of other things too. So we're doing a travel card for creative use of technologies. Anybody can create their own little travel card. They can it's completely open and flexible in that way. So the website is up and running, and we've been tweeting like crazy about it this week. More and more resources will appear on there. But we're also really, really, we welcome anybody who wants to contribute resources they might already have, or suggestions for topics, or anything. It's open. It really is all aboard. it's funded, this project, by the National Forum, and we're incredibly grateful for not just their funding, but their advice and mentorship through the project. But without that funding, it could never have happened. But to maximize the impact of that funding, we're trying to create, as I say, this open system where people can feel that they can contribute. And it belongs to everyone. That's the other thing. It doesn't belong just to the institutions that happen to be in the consortium that set this project up. It belongs to everyone. Now, the digital badges thing has really taken off, and so we've actually been providing advice and support to lots and lots and lots of people far beyond the area of digital skills, and we've seen thousands and thousands of digital badges being issued across the Irish higher education sector, and it's really interesting to see that take off, and we're very happy to continue giving people advice on that. And they're just some examples of some of the different topics that we've produced badges in. Now, I won't go into that in too much detail, but just to say that the badging system has so many really powerful affordances. It's very, very effective if it's done properly and not just issuing badges for breathing or for sitting still in a lecture or something inane. If it's actually a recognition of an achievement or a new skill that's acquired, then it has a lot of potential. Okay, the third aspect, and it's really important, is partnership. That in this project, through all the stages, we try to maximize the engagement of the people for whom we are working. And that includes, in particular, students and student groups. And a huge source of the energy of the project has been the contribution from students, and it's really important to say that. I don't mean that in any patronizing sense at all. I mean it genuinely. If we look at some of the work that's gone on in that area, then we have schemes that have been running initially in the partner institutions called digital champions or digital ambassadors. There are different variants of a similar idea, but it's really that the students are taking control and being involved. In the digital champions case, for example, They're running workshops that they themselves choose the topic, organize. They also campaign around issues such as online safety, digital identity, these sorts of topics. The Digital Ambassadors is a slight variation of that, run in a couple of the other institutions. And that's where the students will do lots of the training and learning, but they will also do an internship in some other part of the organization and help empower that part of the organization to make more effective use of technologies. So they really are an ambassador for the digital. And there's no better ambassador than somebody that's really enthusiastic and passionate about it. We've also been doing research and surveys, producing materials that we are going to share with other people, telling you how you can set up a Digital Champions or Ambassador scheme, some hints and tips, things to, that we have learned. But what's been fascinating is to see the extent to which people have really, as I say, embraced the concept of the Metro Map and all the other kind of aspects round about it. And we really are humbled by this. We didn't expect it. And a lot of our time is spent on dealing with queries and inquiries from people. And we welcome them. It's really, really nice to know when you're sitting on the western periphery of Europe that people are really interested in what you're doing. And that's another key point to make about Ireland and about the potential that's there for Ireland. So our topic, our project has, as I say, spread across other countries. There's a lot of interest. We've also been pleased to see that the National Forum itself has been interested in the potential, for example, of badges and the professional development framework that it's currently working on, and that's great to see. But also, I guess, we've also been really, really, I suppose, flattered by the fact that the Forum and other organizations decided to adopt the Metro Map metaphor and the all aboard idea behind the Digital Skills Week that's going on at the moment. So we're really, really pleased with that. And we want to thank you for doing that. And it's great to see the idea spread. So we try to do things, as I say, that we hope are a bit more fun, a bit more engaging, a bit more participatory, and try and encourage people to come aboard. So hopefully, rather than the yawning cat that we saw earlier on, perhaps some of you are feeling a little bit more intrigued. But really, you know, I just want to thank the Forum for the support, the financial and the moral support as well, and everybody. I want to thank everybody for basically, it looks like, coming aboard. And we've got a lot more of the journey to travel, but it's looking like it's going to be a lot of fun. So thanks very much.
A huge thanks to Ian. I think one of the most important preliminary aspects of the National Forum's work was to say, with the small amount of funding that the National Forum is responsible for applying throughout the sector, it is our responsibility to make sure that we maximise that funding in the most creative and imaginative ways. And a project like All Aboard is a perfect example of how we can leverage the intense work that often goes into that investment in a way that will be sustainable and mainstreamed for many years to come. I think this is a really good example of that. Of course, the champion of this very joined-up thinking that has, I think, been a feature of the National Forum's work is the person who leads the Forum team, and who I don't think there's anybody in the country who doesn't know her now. Her name, just in case you don't know her, if you've been asleep for the last decade, is Dr. Terry Maguire. Terry is the director of the National Forum. Why I'm telling you that, I don't know, because I'm sure you all know that too. Her energy and her commitment and the kind of imagination that she brings along with her 24-hour working day has had an incredible impact on me, and I know on us all. The footprint of Terry Maguire is gigantic, and I think that some of the ways in which she helps us to think about smart innovation and transformative thinking has made an extraordinary difference to the way in which Irish higher education links with all levels of education and all parts of Irish community and society. So the reach has been extraordinary. I think, again, talking about Ian's development of this all aboard concept is that kind of how evocative it has been. We started off as something that, it started off as something that just applied to higher education, but very quickly it became obvious that you can never restrict everything just to higher education. Our students are our students, and human beings are human beings, and we have to connect all the different parts of the system if we're really going to make important changes. And so the fact that the All Aboard framework is equally evocative to primary school teachers, to secondary school, to further education, to employers, to various public bodies and activities, that is its power. And that is why our illustrious panel of digital champions, which represent different parts of that very complex landscape, are here to talk to us today. Each of them is going to talk briefly, but it gives me huge pleasure to invite Dr. Terry Maguire to the podium to introduce them and to manage this part of the discussion.
Thank you, Sarah, and thank you, everybody. When we came up with the idea of having a national initiative for building confidence in digital skills, and we were trying to sell it to the National Forum Board, they said, "You want to do what?" And we tried, when we tried to sell it to the Higher Education Authority, "Can you just explain what the National Forum is actually involved in this for?" And it actually stems from one thing. It stems from the fact when we were doing our consultation for our digital skills roadmap for higher education, our students said to us, "We want a seamless digital experience." I said, "Okay, no problem." So then we're looking around, and if you, we have our roadmap for higher education. At the same time, our further education and training sector, it's got a strategy for technology-enhanced learning. Our schools are being guided by the digital skills strategy. We're all trying to do the same thing. And then you realize that, do you know what? We're not, it's not higher education students, our second level students, our FET students, our primary school students. They all are our students. They're just at a different phase in the education system. So we really need to work together to be able to give that seamless experience for our students in higher education, which they actually wanted. And when we saw what was coming out of the All Aboard project, I went, "That's really interesting." So we went to primary, and we went to second level, and we went to FET, and we went and we said, "Look at this, isn't this really interesting? Don't you think we could all use this?" And All Aboard 2017 is actually showing that for one of the very few times that I know of, everyone across the higher education sector is working on the same framework. Yes, primary school is looking at it through their lens. Our traveller education centres in Wicklow are looking at it through their lens. Our adult literacy learners are looking at it through their lens. But it enables that to happen. And personally, I love the idea that you can refurbish the stations, that you can add new stations, that it's quite dynamic, and it'll actually be something that actually might go on. But the most important thing is that it's accessible. And what we've asked our digital champions to do today is to actually speak on behalf of a particular cohort for which digital skills for learning are important. So it gives me great pleasure to introduce our first digital champion, who's Kathleen O'Connor. And Kathleen is a retired primary school teacher. She was the principal of a rural school in County Laois. She was a member of the Teaching Council from 2012 to 2016. And she's committed to her own lifelong learning. She's currently doing postgraduate work in DCU. And Kathleen is our digital champion for our primary schools. So Kathleen.
Thank you. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. And Terry, thank you for inviting me here today. Well, if you, Lord Puttnam, feel intimidated. You should stand in these shoes right now. However, it gives me great pleasure to address you on the briefly on the importance of building digital skills for learning in primary schools. Sir David has actually answered the question as to why, but I'm just going to give you a brief story, and I have been told not to use visual imagery, which is a pity, so, and I haven't put in the pauses on my speech, but I am going to keep to 5 minutes, so don't worry. Primary schools are exciting and busy places. They are not the same as they were 50 years ago. I know, because I was there. At the age of four and equipped with a pencil and copy, I was prepared to take on the world. The knowledge required for my attempt at world domination would flow initially from my teacher, the very kind Mrs. Jacob. That knowledge was carefully packaged into texts and workbooks to be completed by the month of June each year, and was augmented by a family fiercely interested in education who ensured that we enjoyed weekly visits to the local library, newspapers, radio, black and white television, along with feather-light airmail letters, expanded our horizons beyond that of the local village. There were technological advances in the classroom with the arrival of the reel-to-reel tape recorder. By the time I sat the intercert, and that dates many of us in the room, we could enjoy colour television, and cassette tapes had arrived. Fast forward through the 80s and 90s with the arrival of photocopiers, videos, CDs, DVDs, computer rooms, laptops and the internet, and then into the 21st century with interactive whiteboards, broadband, digital cameras, video tablets and smartphones. Yes, indeed, schools and the tools available for teaching and learning have changed, but the challenge for teachers is to use that kind of the range of technology that we have available to shift the balance from teacher as provider of information to facilitator of learning. And what of the children? The experiences children bring with them to our primary schools today are very different. They inhabit an increasingly visual digital world, their experiences ranging from playing games on computers and tablets, communicating and posting information on social media, accessing information and media on the web, and through to participating in out-of-school computer clubs such as Coder Dojo. These children are learning in different ways, at their own pace, and their learning experiences are not confined to the schools. As 21st century learners, children will be expected to develop the skills of critical thinking, skilled communication, collaboration, creativity, and problem solving, so that they will be equipped to take on the challenges and opportunities that lie ahead. So how can we harness the powers of digital technologies in the development of these skills for all our learners? Well, I am not advocating that we abandon the art of writing, that we empty the school libraries such as this, in favour of a steady diet of e-books, and that we abandon language development in our enthusiasm for developing a digitally skillful and competent cohort of students. But as outlined in both the primary curriculum and the digital skills strategy for schools, ICT should be integrated across the curriculum. From the introduction of digital technologies in primary school, the skill of word processing fitted easily into classroom practice across all subjects as children used the computers to draft, create and edit a final piece of work that could be shared with pride. With the advent of presentations tools, blogs and school websites, children had new audiences for their work. Local history, social and environmental stories could be shared. As internet access became more available, new sources of knowledge could be accessed, and children had to acquire the skills to source and check their information, and importantly, to develop an awareness around copyright. The web provided pupils with access to digital images to illustrate their work, but the availability of affordable digital cameras empowered them to create their own images. Using digital images with accompanying audio or written text, children could work collaboratively to create digital stories and presentations on topics of real interest, sharing their work with classmates or with a wider audience on the web. Digital images also provide a useful assessment tool for children with which to assess their own learning as they review series of images related to particular tasks. Spreadsheets provide pupils with a method of handling larger data sets in math, science and geography, and these skills are regularly on display as children share their research results. The Fiche Film in Schools project fostered the skills of film and video production with teams of children engaged in story development, storyboarding, planning, rehearsing, filming, editing and sharing their work. The skills acquired as part of this project transferred across the curriculum, and children chose to capture and tell their stories using the medium of film. podcasts about school projects and events around individuals in their local community are regularly uploaded to school websites. A glance at the primary science projects presented each year at the BT Primary Science Fair, or at a wide range of projects sponsored by the education centres around the country, will demonstrate how these skills have been embraced by pupils in primary schools. Primary school children are further engaging, more excitingly, I think, with problem solving, collaboration, coding and design thinking. In short, developing computational thinking skills as they engage with BeBots, Scratch, Scratch Junior, WeDo and EV3 Lego Mindstorm kits, Minecraft and app development. These exciting projects also foster creativity, remixing, debugging, persistence and communication skills, and all through the medium of play. That wonderful, wonderful thing. More than just consumers of technology, children are becoming creators, and they're doing so at their own pace. Developing an awareness among all our pupils of online safety and responsible use of digital media is a challenge, but it's one that's always to the forefront of teachers' minds. Fostering and developing a broad suite of digital skills at primary level empowers all learners to access meaningfully the curriculum. And it provides a base for the future of lifelong learning. This has been but a whistle-top tour of some of the stations of that wonderful, wonderful roadmap. It's a very dynamic metro map, I hope, and will accommodate more and more steps and lines along the way, much like the street outside, actually, that we stepped over coming in here. It is certainly an exciting time for both teachers and learners. I wonder what the world will look like 40 years from now for those who started in our primary schools, both teaching and learning, on September 2016. Certainly, when I began my teaching career at the end of the 70s, armed with chalk, the curriculum, and I hope a very active imagination, I could never have envisaged, even with that imagination, the digital opportunities afforded to both teachers and learners as they currently exist. Thank you all for your attention.
Thank you very much, Kathleen. Now, our next digital champion is Neil O'Sullivan. Neil has worked both in mainstream and special education in Ireland for many years. He's the Chief Validator for Digital Schools of Distinction Award, which recognises the integration of ICT in teaching and learning in Irish primary schools. He teaches part-time in Cloister Own in Dublin, and he's currently also planning a national summit on computational thinking, which will take place in June 2017. The summit is going to be the first of its kind in Ireland, and it is designed to further develop digital skill in schools and supports the government's strategy for digital, the government's digital strategy for schools. Neil is also the director of Innovate Together. And Neil is our digital champion for speaking on behalf of Second Level and our Digital Schools of Distinction. Thank you, Neil.
Good afternoon. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. I have five minutes, so I'll rush straight into what I have to say. First of all, as validator, Chief Validator for the Digital Schools of Distinction Award, our programme is designed to encourage teachers like Kathleen to engage and to develop in the teaching and learning and the integration of ICT in teaching and learning. It's a framework where schools can evaluate their performance in their delivery of, or in their usage of technology in their teaching and learning using a self-evaluation tool which we have developed. It focuses on five key areas: leadership and planning, how you might plan for the integration or the better integration of technology in teaching and learning. It focuses on the curriculum and how technology can be used, for example, using the Metro map for integrating technology into teaching and learning. It incorporates a culture and our pride in the use of technology in the school, where a school has a website. They may get involved in inter-school collaboration projects. The work that the kids do are displayed on the school website and engage in other projects nationally and internationally, e-twinning, for example. Then there is a crucial part of it is continual professional development, which, as we know, is an ongoing feature of technology in education, and it really needs to embed confidence in teachers. So we have training courses and working with different education centres around the country. We provide training and advice on teachers who want to learn more about integrating technology. The final feature of the Digital Schools of Distinction Award then is using making making appropriate use of the technologies that you actually have. And again, we have advice and guidelines and standards that schools can engage in. The Digital Schools of Europe is, I suppose, a child of the Digital Schools of Distinction. For example, there are 8 or 9 countries, Finland, Sweden, Denmark, France, Italy, Spain, Portugal, Ireland, are all engaged in looking at the Digital School of Distinction Award that we have here in Ireland, because it really is a bottom-up organisation. There are 3,500 primary schools in Ireland, and 1,600 plus of those schools are actually engaged in becoming Digital Schools of Distinction. And from our work in, as a chief validator visiting schools, we see what's happening on the ground in schools, and we visit schools in the various countries that I've mentioned, and one of the comments that comes back all the time from teachers who visit Irish schools is that maybe we don't have the money for the best technology in the world, but the schools that we visit have enthusiastic teachers. And I think that emphasises the importance of a bottom-up approach. We give the skills and the tools and the resources to the teachers to develop it. And we have schools from one teacher to 50 teachers, where there is absolutely fantastic work going on with the integration of technology in teaching and learning in a cross-curricular basis. My role then as a second-level teacher, I have seen the roadmap, and again, we are very conscious of the continuation of development of technology from primary on to secondary, because some primary schools do fantastic work, like Kathleen outlined, and then when they go into secondary school, with the pressure of the junior cycle and the senior cycle, the creativity is beat out of them, just like Ken Robinson might have mentioned. And we're very conscious of the fact that secondary schools really need to pick up where the primary school teachers have left these children, with huge abilities to create, innovate, critically think, evaluate, communicate, collaborate, and find new ideas and resources. With the national curriculum, the new national strategy, and the development of the idea of computational thinking, we feel this is an opportunity that can be grasped and taken advantage of. And we feel that cross-curricular teaching, and particularly in transition year, maybe in the first year of second-level school, offers the opportunity for more and more integration with and use of technology. But there is one key thing: continual professional development is vital. And guidelines and resources and examples of innovative practice and evolving practice, I won't say best practice because practice gets better and better. This needs to be made available. Teachers love to see good examples of lesson plans. They love to see examples of engaged, active students. With the technology, which is ubiquitous, our students want to engage with technology, they want to use technology. We need to give the teachers ideas, examples, and tools to be able to deliver and teach 21st century skills in a cross-curricular environment with all the other subjects. So that's what I suppose the goal of the Computational Thinking Summit is about on the 20th of June. This will involve engaging the computational thinking skills of abstraction, algorithm design, decomposition and evaluation, persistence, all these tools that we've been, our skills and attitudes that we've been talking about are really part of computational thinking. And you don't actually need a computer to develop computational thinking. It's a problem-solving process that we engage in to a lesser and greater degree every day, but we need to, as Lord Puttnam says, we need to let our students know that there is a vision, there's a journey in doing this, and give them the skills for it to be able to compete in a world exactly that we don't know what is going to be ahead of them, but at least that they'll be able to compete, communicate, collaborate, create, and innovate. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Neil. Our next digital champion is Inez Bailey. Inez is the director of the National Adult Literacy Agency, or NALA. And as the CEO of NALA, Inez has been responsible for initiating the development of the first national quality and assessment framework for the Adult Literacy Service, for devising the first nationally accredited online and distance learning service for adult literacy, using mass media to increase participation rates in adult learning tenfold, and mainstreaming workplace literacy programs. and having successfully lobbied for a legislative amendment to secure an adult literacy strategy within the first strategy for further education and training in Ireland. Inez Bailey is our digital champion for adult literacy learners and those in further education and training.
Very much. I'll bring my phone to keep me on time here. I suppose I just wanted to talk maybe a little bit about people who are often excluded from the education system, which I don't think we're often aware of how often that happens and how detrimental it can be for people. And I suppose when I started working in the whole area of adult learning, it was a shock to me that there were people who hadn't had a very strong or beneficial experience from education. And I was really intrigued about how that had happened and possibly more importantly, what were we doing about it. And around the late 90s, we were looking at very high levels of adult literacy issues in Ireland and a very low level of service. And one of the things we could see happening, I suppose, globally was the embracing of technology as kind of a solution to this area. But because we were, I suppose, coming from a very low base of investment, high technology seemed beyond us. So we started to look at low technology. And at that time, low technology was actually radio and indeed to an extent television. And we looked at how we could use radio as a form of, I suppose, access for people around education. And a very small little initiative was tried and tested and people liked it and we kind of got some confidence from that. So we moved from there into television. And television was a really interesting, I suppose, medium to look at in terms of something that Lord Puttnam mentioned. It tends to have very good production values if it's going to be produced for the masses. So we got some really, really interesting engagement from television producers, from RTE, and funding coming in latter years from the Broadcasting Authority of Ireland to look at how you could bring content together, learning content of very different, I suppose, subject areas, but that would be actually accessible for people who have literacy and numeracy issues, but was designed with a very high quality attached to it. And when we started to see how many people were, A, watching those television series, because I could tell you RTE were not really very optimistic when we started this enterprise. They really did think people wouldn't watch the programmes. But when the ratings came in, they were really, really impressed that slots that were perhaps maybe not performing as well as they'd want them were actually starting to perform very well with this kind of learning content, accessible learning content. So we grew from that to the idea that actually maybe we could attach more and more, I suppose, learning opportunities for people who are watching these television series, and we looked at then the higher technology. And we created a product called writeon.ie, which in effect is a free online learning platform. It's, I think, still unique in the world, insofar as what it does is it enables people to go on and who are people designed for people with literacy and numeracy issues. It's designed for them to go online to learn modules that are available through the national the qualifications framework across a whole range of modules, either thematically or according to certain subjects, to have recognition of their prior learning. So if they actually already know an awful lot of these skills and don't know it or would like to get that recognised, they can get the RPL facility thrown in as well. And one of the things we found was that, first of all, most providers and indeed practitioners said that this couldn't be done and wouldn't actually be embraced by the learners themselves. But we stayed very strong to listening to learners. And when we did that, I think that gave us the bravery to keep going, because actually people loved learning online and they didn't necessarily have literacy and numeracy barriers that stopped them doing that. But if they did, they were very driven to get over their literacy and numeracy barriers so that they could continue on learning online. And I suppose the lasting memory that it gave us was that people really did feel that they were learning in a way that everybody else was learning. So it brought them into, I think, education or back into education. And I think that was something that they felt wasn't necessarily ever going to happen again in their life after being excluded for it. So I would just like to say it's a kind of an inspirational story about what people themselves can do once they can get online and indeed start embracing learning opportunities and see a whole future and a pathway that obviously the All Aboard framework, I think, will supply a lot of people that we're working with who want to learn more and certainly will need that open access to enable them to do that. But it also is a testament, I think, to the people involved in this particular project that it is both open access and it has reached out to people across the education and training sector, because often these are, I suppose, the very people who will be excluded from a lot of the very powerful learning opportunities that are available through all of our institutions, but often exclude this group of people. So we're really grateful that they have been included and that we're able to contribute to the content of the programme and indeed support it going forward. Thank you very much.
Well, I'm not sure our next digital champion needs that much introduction. Micheal Muircheartaigh requires, he's a much-loved former teacher, a broadcaster, an author, who first came to prominence following the famed Polo Grounds All-Ireland Final in 1947. And for many years afterwards, the instantly recognisable voice could be heard commenting on the minor matches as Gaeilge. Now, Micheal has recently championed things digital when he worked with David on the RTE programme Making Ireland Click. And we're delighted that he has agreed to be one of our digital champions, speaking on behalf of community. Micheal.
Good. I think you got the date slightly mixed up. It was 1949. I didn't get a trip to New York. And the reference of New York there is a very, very good example of the complete change that has taken place in many facets of Irish life. To those of you that might not be followers of Gaelic football, the All-Ireland Final of 1947 was played in New York. It was a decision taken as a gesture to the emigrants, and emigrants of those years and before it rarely ever came home. They hadn't the time, holidays weren't that long, and so on. The interesting thing that only one journalist from Ireland went to cover that. One. That was somebody say, Mitchell Cogley was sent by the Independent. Now, if such a thing was happening, the All-Ireland Final of 2018 or 2017 to be played, we'll say, in Melbourne, you'd need a special plane to bring all the journalists and, different angles to journalism to do it. And that's a very good example. Now, listening to the speakers from the time we had Lord Puttnam on here, the one thing I'm convinced that will drive it all is a high level of curiosity about advances. And curiosity brings enthusiasm, brings further research, buying into it. And the first thing of curiosity that I would mention, now this has nothing to do with the digital age or anything, way, way back in 1907, there was an All-Ireland Final played in Thurles between Kildare and Kerry. And Kerry had won the two previous ones, and it was fantastic news when Kildare beat them. And a Kildare man, and I read this in the Kildare paper of the time, he was walking up the street afterwards, happiest man in the world, you can understand, but he was sorry that the people at home have no idea yet what happened. And then he got a brainwave. He saw a house with post office written out there. There's a house like that in Nace, and there are rumours going around that if you were in it, you could speak to somebody that's not there at all. And very few believed it at the beginning. But he said, I will put it to the test. He was curious, and he knocked at the door, opened by a postmaster, put him the plain question, is it true that you could speak to somebody who's not here at all? Indeed, I could. There's a man in Nace with a house like yours. They were all built alike. Could you talk to him? I could. Could you tell him that Kildare have beaten Kerry? And he said, I will indeed come in with me, and I'll show you how it's done. Now, that was a new innovation. And he described sort of the way he operated. and spoke to the man Inez. And when it was all over then, he said to him, there's a man with a house like it in Salins as well, should I tell him? Now, that was the first result of any type of sport ever sent in the air. But the curiosity developed. And they were building post offices all over the country at the time. And post offices then, wherever the big match of the day would be, or other matches as well, somebody would deliver the result to the post office and then they would send it to what post office would list. That was a major advance, and people brought into it, they were enthused by it. It helped their own interest. And that's what the digital age has to do. Get people curious, get them inquisitive, let them take it a step further and try it out, and tell others about it. Now, come back again to sport. I've been involved in sport for a long number of years. Ireland had its first radio station in 1926 on the 1st of January. There was radio in England and France and Spain and Germany and Italy and America and all these places before that, but not having a government of our own, I suppose, until 1923, you could say, we had none. But they had it listed, we will have our own. They were looking ahead rather than looking back. Looking ahead, it went on the air on the 1st of January. Douglas Hyde was the first to speak on it. Very, very enthusiastic about it and very, very positive. We'll be on the air every day for 3 hours, I think. It's round the clock now. It was the only radio station in Ireland. There are 44 of them there now. Huge advance. But the interesting thing from, if you like, things technical happened. In the month of August that year, a member of the small staff situated or located in the GPO, he got an idea. Told nobody present, out the street, up to Croke Park, whatever office they had in Jones's Road at the time, and he said he was from the new radio station 2RN, and we have equipment that would make it possible to have a man here next Sunday when Kilkenny go out to Horrell Galway, and anybody that has a wireless would know, as that man described what was happening, they would know instantly what was happening. That was a big advance in the telephone call. And they said, sure, we'll try it. And the strange thing is that was the first sport event anywhere in the entire world that went out on radio. Nobody had thought that sport would be, or that radio would be a suitable medium for sport. And it all stemmed from a person, he had an idea. He wasn't afraid people would laugh at him or anything. He was willing to put it to the test again. He was optimistic about it. He was curious about how it would work and so on. And it did work, and you can see the huge industry that broadcasting is now. Now, to come back to what we're speaking about this week, promotion, creating a greater interest than the big interest that's there already, within all the whole year. And it said that some speaker mentioned here today, you've got to get everyone involved. It's not just primary education, it's not just the pupils and the teachers. Backup staff was mentioned. Very, very important. And if you like, that postmaster in Thurles in 1907, he was the first, if you like, support. It was his idea, the support. I'll do it, I'll ring, and I'll ring Sally. And that's a big, big help when you're advancing any cause. And certainly the coming of the digital age and the different developments since then, I think is a fantastic thing. We all have benefited by it. Some people are doubtful. That wouldn't work. Our ancestors did without a window. The modern age, they're very, very positive. Now, I go to a lot of schools, and I find them enthusiastic. I find that they know, learn, they can almost learn things themselves. And then when it's a feature of the school learning and so on, I think we're on a good foundation. But to take it all the way from the very top of higher level education down to the primary school, it must be involved in all of them. And they will cooperate. I remember being in a rural school down in Westmeath. There were only 32 pupils in the whole school. And they were all brought together while I was answering questions from them. And I saw a little lad in the front seat. He was no more than maybe 7 years old. He was taking a photograph of me. And I said, how many of you have your own phone? I was astounded, and this is maybe 5 or 6 years ago. 25 of the 32 had. Now, I think in a way, that's a good thing. People talk about abusing things. Their confidence. Confidence has grown. And being used to facilities like that and the new ones coming and coming all the time. Now, the first time I got into it, I was asked by Penguin, would I write my autobiography? And I said, there's no way I'll do it the way I've been doing articles for different newspapers over the years with the typewriter that I won playing golf or that I exchanged with somebody who won it. And he had no respect for it, he said. No. And I said, now, I'll exchange my prize for that if you're happy. And we made a few golf balls to the person who had the more valuable one. I had the typewriter. I wrote articles in that. But I had to deliver them to the different places or post them if they'd be far away places. But I said then, I'm going to get a computer if I'm going to write the autobiography. I knew a little bit about them from seeing, you know, other people using them. It was for a long time before they became fashionable by the journalists. Every journalist now has a computer. They can write their report, send it off, contact with the whole world. But only for the computer I wouldn't have written any one of the three books I did. All the things it can do. I learned according to the needs I had at the time. I have been involved with Third Age. That's, if you like, they look after elderly people all over the country. They get them in local communities to come together. They're brought on outings and trips, and there are lessons and everything for them. And they're all nowadays encouraged to have a computer. And this learn, and what they love more than anything is they have children abroad. I have 4 members of my family are abroad from Aberdeen to Singapore, and you can Skype and you can see them there and so on. All these things that are possible with a little knowledge and curiosity. All those types of things are taking shape. Another thing that's great benefit to communities, organizations like the Sheds, started in Australia. I remember the first person to come to Ireland talking about it. I went to hear him out of curiosity. Again, people, retired people who have a bit of energy, someplace where they could gather. They wouldn't have a room as nice as this, but they'd have sufficient accommodation. And all facilities, there'd be computers there, there'd be for handcrafts and anything that the people want would be supplied, and they learn and they come together as a community. And again, the digital age is a great help to those. Now, I'm very hopeful that within a short time, there'll be huge advances made, created by curiosity, enthusiasm, and interest, and the backups that are there now at all levels. When we have them all, O Vun Gabor, and I'll finish with an Irish proverb, Ni Nart Gukur Lekeil. You don't appreciate what can be accomplished until everyone are pulling in the right direction in what's good for them. Ramil Mahalib Khart.
Our next digital champion is our cultural digital champion. Clare Lanigan is the Education and Outreach Manager for the Digital Repository of Ireland. She is responsible for the repository's training programme, which was launched in 2016. Her interests include digital and web archiving, audiovisual collection management, training and education, and digital preservation.
Hi there. It's a bit of a tough act to follow, but I'll try and be. I don't know if I can be quite as entertaining, but I'll try. So I just wanted to introduce the Digital Repository of Ireland to anyone who might not be familiar with it. It's a national repository for Ireland's digital cultural heritage. And what that means is that we store digitized and born digital versions of various types of cultural information, including photographs, including scanned letters, including research data, including a broad range of other objects from national cultural institutions like the National Library or the National Museum or the Royal Irish Academy and many others, or from research institutions like universities or from smaller community archives. We're open to all institutions or organizations that are working with cultural and historical and humanities archive information. So it's built up of a consortium of partners, including the Royal Irish Academy, which is where the administrative base is, and also Trinity College Dublin, Maynooth University, and the National University of Ireland in Galway. There's an access point where all the collections can be viewed online, which is repository.dri.ie, but that is not just many things that call themselves digital archives are not much more than a website, but the point of DRI is that all the items that we have stored in our digital repository are kept in what's known as federated storage, which is a high-tech version of long-term digital preservation. The objects and all the collections are designed to be accessible in the future across different format changes, across software changes, across hardware changes. The point of it is long-term digital preservation, not just having something available online for a short period. So the long-term storage is a really key part of our work. And everything that we do, we also do training and publications. We publish a number of guidelines for things like metadata standards, which are important for any institution or group that are looking to deposit data in DRI. And we also run a training course for people or for institutions that are looking to sign up. That's the training course that Terry mentioned there. And they are basically introducing, sometimes they're quite basic ones, introducing people to the principles of digital archiving, which working on archiving principles in general, and then specifics to do with the digital aspect when it comes to archiving. And also running through more detailed things like copyright, metadata standards, and more kind of imprecise levels of collection management. We also try and run practical workshop sessions as often as possible to allow people to use a repository in real time so that they get the practice that they need. So I thought for today I might mention two particular projects within DRI that would be of particular interest for teaching and learning at kind of all levels, really. There is a series of online exhibitions that we launched beginning in 2014, but kind of coming into their own in the last 2 years. And they're all under the aegis of the Inspiring Ireland project, which was a specially curated series of exhibitions which takes material from many of our national cultural institutions, including the National Library and the National Museum and the RT Archives and various other institutions as well, and also includes material taken from people's personal memorabilia collections, which we had things known as collection days, where for our 1916 specific exhibitions, people brought in memorabilia associated with their families to do with 1916, and we provided digitization in the National Library. They were our partners in this, and then they were able to store that digitized material into our repository and then create exhibitions around it. So the Inspiring Ireland 1916 exhibitions were launched last year. They were supported by Ireland 2016 under the aegis of the Department of Arts and Heritage. And there were a number of themed exhibitions using the type of material that I just described. And the themes were broad-ranging, but some of the more popular ones included women in 1916 and 1916 in the regions, which I think sometimes the more less spoken about stories are the ones that are more that have more interest, especially last year in the whole Ireland 2016 program. I should mention that all these are available at inspiring-ireland.ie. Each themed exhibition was accompanied by an expert essay, which was usually given by an academic with an expertise in the field, which was really great for contextualizing the information. And the exhibitions, as both by going with the theme, often tended to draw out elements of it that might not have been immediately obvious. That's why they're particularly useful in a teaching and learning environment. There's one particular object from Inspiring Ireland 1916 I'd like to kind of focus in on. It's from the Women and the Rising section of the exhibition, and it's the title of it is the Lizzie Walsh Compensation File. And what this refers to is a documentation that was submitted by a maid named Lizzie Walsh, whose uniform was destroyed when a hotel on O'Connell Street was burned down during the Rising. And as a maid, she was actually obliged to pay for her own uniform, so she couldn't get a new job until she got a new uniform, and she couldn't afford a new uniform because she didn't have a job. So she claimed for compensation from the state after the Rising had finished. And that item was in the National Military Archives, and the digitized version is in our exhibition. The reason why I think that's interesting is that it shows that the story of the Women and the Rising is not just the Manana Hare that we've all heard about. It's not just about Constant Markovitz, and it's not just about Grace Gifford, interesting and all as those people are. It's also about ordinary people who maybe had no political connections whatsoever, whose lives were still impacted by the Rising. Another exhibition that's particularly interesting to people who are working in teaching and learning is a more recent one called Frangook. Frangook, Recreating a Lost Landscape. This also kind of falls under the umbrella of Inspiring Ireland 1916, but it focused in specifically on the Frangook internment camp in Wales, where some of you probably heard of it, where a number of the leaders of the 1916 Rising were sent after the Rising, and it was often termed Ulskul na Réabhlóide because so many of the leaders ended up forming connections in that internment camp that they wouldn't have otherwise, and were more boosted politically by it. And we turned out we had a great deal of material in them, especially from our people's collections. And we found that there was enough there to form its own exhibition. So we decided to collaborate with both, again, supported by the Department of Arts and Heritage in Gaeltacht, and we collaborate with the People's Collection of Wales, which is an initiative of the National Library of Wales and the National Museum of Wales. And we got this great cross-country collaboration, which was really, really fruitful for all of us, and launched this exhibition last December. And again, it was made up out of material from national cultural institutions and from the public. And we found some very interesting material from the public and from all the institutions. One item I'd like to kind of focus on again in a similar way is an autograph book that was kept by one of the prisoners, whose name was Sean McStiffon. The autograph book belonged to somebody else, but there's a section in it where this person would go around and collect names of everybody in the camp. It was a kind of a habit at the time where people just kept autograph books and they got everyone to sign it, famous or otherwise. People sometimes wrote little poems or drew pictures or something like that. And there's one page of this which is a little inscription by Sean McStiffon, who was one of the rebels at the time and who went on to work in Dublin City Libraries, and actually his son was the noted architect Sam Stevenson. But this man wrote a little quote, and the quote was, "A crank is a small thing that turns a revolution." And it's a very memorable little quote, and it actually comes from Francis Sheehy Skeffington, who, for those of you who know of him, was a pacifist who did not want to be involved in the Rising but supported the aims of the rebels, and was actually arrested and executed by British military personnel simply for being a witness to them doing an extrajudicial killing. So the kind of confluence of different figures coming together in this quite innocent little object that we wouldn't have seen if not for the fact that somebody brought it from their personal collection to be digitized and to be brought into the Frangook exhibition is a really good example of a kind of a type of serendipity that happens when you kind of focus on bringing digital collections, not just making them available, but also make them available in a curated way that speaks to the needs that people have when they're teaching and learning, and also just for curious people in the outside world. We have a number of other collections that are also of interest to those in research and those in teaching. We have a number from the Irish Qualitative Data Archive, which is a social sciences archive, which has a number of material from interviews with Irish people across the century, and covers many, many interesting cultural and social change. All these are available, again, on repository.dri.ie. And then the regular website, dri.ie, has links to all our publications and other information. And so all of those are easily available, and nearly all our collections are open access. So I'd just like to close by just saying that it's really good to be here today. We really want to keep pushing our kind of connections to the world of education. We've been speaking with the National Council National Educational Council about possibly collaborating with teachers in presenting material from the repository for use in the junior circuit history curriculum, either informally or formally. And we also, again, have a strong connection to the higher education sector as well. So again, it's really good to be here today and to meet all of you, and I hope that some of you who may not have been familiar with DRI will get a chance to explore it further. Thanks very much.
And thank you for your patience. I know we've gone a little bit over time. Lunch will be just a few minutes away, I promise. But I'll just introduce our last digital champion. I'd like to introduce Donal Maguire, who's the Director of Aquaculture Development for On Board the Isla Vara, also better known, I suppose, as BIM, the Irish Seafoods Development Agency. And Donal has championed the importance of having digital skills for growing and developing our industries in a digital world.
Try and stay on time or maybe even bring back some time. First of all, thank you very much to the National Forum for the opportunity to speak in these wonderful surroundings. And from a Bord Ishkiwara point of view, it's lovely to note that the Mission for Seafarers is next door as well, so they're very much a community close to our heart. I suppose what I'd like to talk to you about is something very simple, actually, in comparison perhaps to some of the previous speakers, but it's not an exaggeration to say that it's actually genuinely a matter of life and death. For some time, we've been running a program called Live to Tell the Tale, and that's about encouraging Irish fishermen to wear life jackets. And it sounds terribly simple, but actually there's a long history involved in this. And I suppose if you think about the Irish seafood industry and you wonder where does seafood come from, it either has to be farmed or somebody has to go out and catch it. And going out to catch it or even to go out to sea to farm it is a hazardous business. We have the highest energy coastline in the world, and we have the biggest waves and the most frequent bad weather. And it is a dangerous occupation. Statistically, it's the most dangerous occupation in the world, as you've probably seen from programs like Deadliest Catch, where everybody now begins to realize just how dangerous it is to be a commercial fisherman or a commercial fish farmer. And, you know, in some ways people think about the fishing industry in Ireland, and perhaps they think about the wonderful super trawlers that go out of Killybegs or the big whitefish boats that leave Castletown Bear Haven. They're actually, you know, the big bulk of our industry on the one hand, but on the other hand, that's not where most people are employed. There are about 1,800 vessels in the Irish fleet. Only about 80 of those come under the heading of a trawler. The rest of them are small inshore vessels. And that's where most people earn their living in the Irish industry. And many of those vessels are manned by people on their own or at most two people. And there was a long tradition in the Irish industry of not wearing life jackets, unfortunately, because they were regarded as cumbersome, they were regarded as heavy, for all sorts of reasons. So Bord Ishkiwara, working with the manufacturers of life jackets for quite a long time, has been trying to break this idea, but also trying to work to come up with a better life jacket. And it's, again, it sounds surprisingly simple, but actually it isn't. So in recent times, we have come up with this very durable, very compact, small life jacket that's worn like a collar, just over the shoulders, which inflates automatically if a person is unfortunate enough to go into the water. And so we thought, that's great, that's one big problem solved. But of course, that doesn't really solve the problem, because if somebody does go in the water and they're from a small boat, perhaps on their own, Irish waters are very cold. So people will not survive very long in those waters unless they're rescued. Along came another wonderful technological innovation. And that innovation is called a personal locator beacon, a PLB. These in the past were things that were only carried on ships. But technology has advanced to the point now where there are tiny little things which can actually be built into the life jacket. So if somebody is unfortunate enough to find themselves in the water, the life jacket inflates automatically, they find themselves in the correct orientation, and now they can activate their PLB. We had a situation just recently last week where a fisherman was unfortunate enough to find himself in the water, a lone fisherman, off the Donegal coast. His life jacket deployed as it should. He activated his PLB. Within half an hour, he was in Letterkenny Hospital, only suffering from mild hypothermia. He'd been airlifted. In the past, that would have been a tragedy. That would have been a casualty and a loss at sea. So where does all this bring us to where we're interested in all aboard? These personal locator beacons, each of them has an individual signature. And those have to be registered with ComReg, so that when and if, unfortunately, somebody finds themselves in the water, they activate the beacon sends a signal up to a satellite, the satellite alerts the rescue services that there is an emergency signal being transmitted. The emergency services then have to go online and say, whose is it? Is it a real emergency or is it a false alarm? And this is very serious, because as we can see from the terrible tragedy in Rescue 116, the emergency services cannot lightly initiate a rescue. So it's vitally important that anybody who has one of these life jackets and uses the PLB engages with ComReg. How do you engage with ComReg? You must register online. And this is where we came to find that there was a really strong issue for BIM. At this stage, we've probably granted and assisted with the issuing of more than 1,000 of these life jackets. But we were finding that there wasn't 1,000 registrations going to Comreg. So my colleague, Dee Moore, who's just here, we've been trying to engage with the fishermen. And of course, these are a cohort of people who are, many of them, 40 plus, 45 plus. Some of them may have literacy issues. They're not the natural cohort of people to use digital skills. So we've developed, amongst other measures, a little unit which allows them to download from the BIM website a step-by-step guide so that they can register their beacon with Comreg easily and quickly. And in doing so, if they are unfortunate enough to find themselves in the water, then they will be rescued really quickly, and we hope to have far more positive outcomes for everyone concerned. So that's why we're really pleased to be involved, and thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Donal, and thanks to the entire panel for the stories that they've told us. It always strikes me how it's the stories that we come away with and how that enlivens and connects us in all sorts of important ways. I know that we've gone a little bit over time, and I know that lunch awaits, but I did want to bring together some of the ideas. Remember that this morning was just a smattering and just a kind of an indicator and just a set of signals of all of the developments that are going on around the country and which are kind of really represented in the 300 plus events that are being coordinated this week. But these speakers this morning have reminded us of some very important things. David has inspired us as ever. He has begun today's conversation, but of course has been part of that conversation for a very, very long time. And I think, again, how important his role has been in constantly reminding us of the challenges that still exist and how much still needs to be achieved and the obstacles that still exist and lie ahead that we must try together to dismantle. To Ian, for sharing those challenges within a particular context, and for showing us how those challenges are being addressed through his extraordinary leadership and through the coherence of the All Aboard framework, which everybody is becoming more and more familiar with and connecting with. To Kathleen, for stories of how far we've come. And it's good to be reminded that things 50 years ago are different, that there is access, that the kind of sense of the gradual development of digital engagement is something that sometimes we need to recognise as having happened in quite transformative ways, recognising, of course, that there is a great way to go and that we still have much work to do. To Niall, I think, Niall, the showing how you can drive important, technologically relevant work like computational skills even in situations where resources are limited. I think that was a major message for me from all of the important things that Neil was telling us. To Inez for reminding us how access to online learning must be open to all and can make a particularly disproportionate difference to people to whom it's traditionally been denied or who have not had access. And I think that's an important message and we must be reminded of. And it's interesting, Inez, you of all people with your leadership in NALA, saying how shocking and surprising that is, that we can sometimes occupy bubbles within the education sector, not realising how difficult it is for some people in parts of that sector. So I'm grateful to you on all our behalf for reminding us of that. To Micheal for his insights and memories and stories, and I think one of the things that the many things that he reminded us of, one of which is that human beings have always been designed to reach out and to connect. We always have had that need, and that working to make technology help us to do that is part of its purpose. We earlier this week talked to Wayne Denner, who was talking about the dangers and the risks and how absolutely vital it is for educational institutions to take leadership in making sure that technology doesn't control people, that people control technology and are empowered by it, not diminished in any way by it. Clare, I mean, you know, again, all of the connections, I think, We operate in a national forum in the RIA building, and Clare for teaching us more about the role that digitisation is playing in creating archives and stories that we can always have access to, and access in that informed pedagogical way that you so beautifully described. And also, I think, for giving us something of the richness and importance of those stories by selecting some of the examples that you did. And that was enormously thoughtful, Clare, and I think it really helped us to see how that works and why it is so important. To Donal for reminding us that technology matters to everybody. It's not some Orwellian controller of ourselves and our identities, but that used properly, clearly, it can enhance our learning, our lives, and how sometimes it can literally save us. Terry for helping to keep us all on the tracks, to extend the metaphor, and to her incredible National Forum team who have worked so hard to help us climb aboard. I'm proud to be part of this. I, on behalf of the entire Forum board and the sector, I thank everybody who's been so involved in this week and for everything that it represents. I'm grateful to all of you, and particularly to our student representatives for whom all of this is about. And I warmly invite you now to join us for lunch. Thank you very much.